Parental discretion is advised.
This show is brought to you by Slice on Broadway, supporting Pittsburgh podcasting with the perfect pepperoni pizza, sliceonbroadway.com. And listeners like you, support this show at patreon.com/wrestlingmayhemshow. Just wait, just wait. It's the Wrestling Mayhem Show. The gang's all here. I'm at Sorgatron, Mike Sorg, in Mayhem Studios in Pittsburgh, PA, ready to talk professionalized wrestling with you today, this evening, or whatever time you get your ear holes on this. With me, I got a great, great lineup tonight. First of all, of course, from San Antonio, Texas, he is the voice of Inspire Pro Wrestling, Eamon Payton, at Eamon2Please on the Twitters.
Hello, sir. Hello, everyone in the Mayhem Nation. I'm excited to be on this week and talking about wrestling. That's my intro. I can't think of witty intros anymore, Sorg. I feel like I'm failing.
You should just write a bunch of them, and then, like, you know, when you're on the toilet, and you know, put them in that little drafty thing on your phone, and then you pull one up. I think that's how DJ Lunchbox.
How Lunchbox did it for like years.
I think that's exactly what he did. Also with us from Poughkeepsie, New York, the only one on the staff right now that has a future endeavor letter from World Wrestling Entertainment. He is Mad Mike.
Hey Sorg, I don't need a witty intro because I have a marvelous playoff beard going.
There you go. He beats you with the beard. Yeah. There you go. And also with us from California, PA, he is the sound dude over at Renegade Wrestling Alliance. He gets more hugs from Karen Jarrett than I ever will. He is Wheels. Hot Wheels RWA.
What's up, folks? After a great Friday of wrestling and hugs and laughter and entertainment, I'm ready to talk some more wrestling.
Awesome, man. We'll talk about that Global Force Wrestling show over on Indie Mayhem Show, recording later this evening, of course, or go check that out on iTunes or wherever you're getting your podcast or video feed of the show. But let's, of course, this is the Wrestling Mayhem Show. Check us out. We're over at WrestlingMayhemShow.com. Subscribe to us in all the places in audio and video formats. And, of course, you can drop us a line at that email address.
Good times
at WrestlingMayhemShow.com or 412-206-WMS0. Join us here live every Tuesday night at live.WrestlingMayhemShow.com, including our awesome chat room tonight. Tragar's hanging out in there, as well as Juggalo John, some dude named Miles. I don't know if it's a real person. Riz is in there. Riz plays games, of course, as well. He'll be joining us a little later, I believe, for the draft. And also, you can check us out, patreon.com/wrestlingmayhemshow. You don't have to give us money, though we really do appreciate it if you would like to. And we do have a few that do. Five Patreons are in there right now and giving cash to the show. But share the show. It's okay. Share the show. Tell a friend about it and let them know about why you think it's cool and they should become part of the Mayhem Nation. And we'll be talking about some interesting things we'll be doing to try to expand the Mayhem Nation. But thank you to our friends that are on there right now. Of course, Bo Diggity!
Woo!
First of all, and of course, the longest running Patreoner. Even though Patreon screwed him over and took away his first tag, I believe, our good buddy Tony Garza in El Paso, Texas, the WrestlingRevolution.com, the Matthew and Jennifer Carlin's Foundation for Podcast Betterment, Ed Burke, and our friend Alex Cars from Occupy Pro Wrestling. Jeez, I always want to say obsessed with wrestling. I'm so sorry. One of these weeks, that's my latest thing, right? There's always something. Wait till we get to Night of Champions. And I say
that's always
again.
Fun.
That's the yearly tradition where I screw something up. But anyways, so let's get into the show. The topics for this week, first of all, well, we want to start on a happy note. NXT's Takeover is happening. Maybe it's already happened by the time you listen to this show. But we really haven't full on talked about NXT for a while on this show. And I know some of you guys here do this midweek war show where you're catching up with it. And I've been late watching NXT, so I actually haven't caught up with your show all that much lately. Your opinions will be new to me, at least, on this. So first of all, Takeover the End. Are we concerned with this title? Of course, we're headlining with a steel cage match with Finn Balor and Samoa Joe, who have been battling for at least three takeovers straight, I think, at this point. Actually, a storyline that started way back in the fall with the tag team tournament, really. What do you think going into this? Are you worried about the end moniker?
It's very up in the air, obviously. There's parts where it's like, oh no, it'll be fine, because they announced that Takeover Brooklyn tickets were being going on sale, not like today or whatever. So I was like, oh, that's good. But then Triple H's conference call happened and said that Takeover the End will have a lot of different meanings and you'll see them play out on the show. And it's like, okay, what the fuck does that mean? I don't know what it means. Obviously, with the brand split that is going to be looming, yeah, I don't know. Everything's very up in the air about it.
What about you, Mad Mike?
Well, considering I'm going to wake up early tomorrow to use my pre-sale code to get Takeover tickets, I'm not overly concerned. I think they're just realizing that NXT has had a lot of call-ups really quickly, and the roster is kind of thinned out a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
The tag team division in NXT is still booming, the best tag team division we have going. But I think this draft is – it might end up being a three-show draft.
Hmm.
And we might see some guys – like we might see William Regal representing NXT. And he might take some guys like Jack Swagger or something like that. And so, I think we could absolutely see something like that happening.
So you think that the NXT is going to become kind of a lesser show, kind of a trade down effect for a lot of these people instead of being just a developmental?
Yeah, like DCW on Sci-Fi.
Yeah, exactly. So, I mean, but obviously people that would, you know, benefit from a repackage and redo, right? Like, because, I mean, I look what's happened with your Zack Ryders and Emmas at this point. I mean, one was at WrestleMania and another one came back and it was not fired for shoplifting until she got injured, right? It is that repackage area. It is that place where these people can go and find themselves a little bit, right?
Yeah, I mean, look at Tyson Kidd. Tyson Kidd was probably going to get fired.
And it gets people with experience, regardless of how they're doing on the main roster as far as package response and stuff like that, that can help rub elbows with these kids. You know, throw them down there with the hungry people and see how they respond, right? Yeah. I mean, it makes sense.
I do hope we get more of a, like maybe a mix of guys like coming down from the main roster to NXT. I think one, that could be helpful. Two, I also think that as much as I like it, like we're falling to this kind of thing with NXT where it's like, oh, we're bringing in this new big star and this new one. And it's kind of, we're seeing too big of an influx of those people as well. Like it's almost too many like new people instead of like the, and it's all like the story's all focused like, oh, these are the greatest talents in the world in this one place, instead of kind of cultivating their own show. You know what I mean?
I kind of get what Eamon's going for here. Like in baseball terms, NXT's kind of becoming the Yankees, where they're bringing in free agents instead of building their farm system.
Hmm. Which is funny, since it is kind of supposed to be the farm system.
Yeah.
Right. Mm-hmm. But
I just wish they would hopefully like develop some more stuff in there, because like, yeah, you can bring in all these great people, but it's also like, once those people are influx, like, then what do you have? You know what I mean? Like, NXT is still only a one-hour show, at least for now.
Right.
Like, it can still get very congested.
True, true. What about you, Wheels? What do you think about the state of NXT going into this TakeOver show?
Honestly, I mean, I'm agreeing with Mike and Eamon on a lot of things. I mean, I'd rather see it stay as, like, almost a farming-type deal. But honestly, seeing people like maybe a Zack Ryder, who has gotten a little better and seen more on TV again, like maybe send John Cena down there and let him help build up some of the other people or something like that.
I don't know if I'd send John Cena down there.
Yeah, no. Wouldn't that be hilarious if they sent Zack Ryder back down there again? Like, hey, we're going to try out this new stuff with you. Like, maybe we'll refresh you up. And he's like, didn't we just do that with Mojo?
And if that happens, Eamon, oh, wow. We're going to surprise him with this. But no, honestly, sending Cena down there would be like what AJ said last night is, oh, you get to wrestle John Cena, so that means we're going to be buried worse than NXT?
I don't know about that. Not to go off on different talks, but I didn't agree with that promo last night. I actually thought John Cena made more sense in that promo than AJ Styles did.
I think you should ask Rusev and Bray Wyatt what they thought of AJ's promo.
But you should also ask guys like Kevin Owens.
Yeah, you could ask Kevin Owens. He's just now getting back to where he was.
He was always fine. He was always fine, I think.
Okay.
I'm with you. I'm with Eamon on that one. Well, guys, I think in the long run, what I think the end is going to be and what we're going to see from the end, and this is my shot in the dark, this is my big prediction of the night for that one, I think the end, we're gonna have the show, the match is going to be done, and what we're going to get is a Chikara season ender crazy night where they end up kicking all the fans out and the feed goes out.
Someone said this would be NXT Takeover, Never Compromise.
Yes. And then NXT will disappear for a year and we'll get mysterious promos just breaking in on the WWE network until then. And then it comes back. And maybe there'll be a couple random NXT shows that kind of pop up that nobody really heard about. Or maybe what you'll get is we'll find three other promotions, one starting with an N, one starting with an X, one starting with a T. Right, Eamon? I mean, the formula is there.
Well, the possible rumor that the end is related to a new independent wrestler that they signed, which if that's the case, that's just fucking the most trolly thing ever. Like,
right. As opposed to everything Finn Balor has done on YouTube in front of cell phone videos.
Basically.
We still have people.
It could be really funny if, like, this led to like a main roster Nexus invading NXT.
That could be interesting, but it worked out so well the first time. But Mike, you're like,
worked out so well every time they've done that.
I still have people commenting on the YouTube video that Mike took of Finn Balor talking about how he's staying in NXT, asking when's he coming to Raw. Like,
we don't fucking know. Damn it! I don't think he knows, honestly.
Yeah, no.
Oh, I think he knows.
No, I think he's just fucking with people.
Think he's going, doing some wrestling, painting himself up, and going home and playing some Legos and watching SummerSlam 95.
I really hope he doesn't end up on SmackDown.
Yes.
No, because painting up like a big blue demon, nope, that's not going to fly.
Nope. Color schemes, people. Oh, anyways. But either way, okay, the matches. Ugh. Of course, I think this is a Finn Balor wins this one out. I think Samoa Joe's there. Yeah. I think Balor's going to be the two-time guy. If anybody, he is the guy in NXT. I don't think anybody has been as big as Finn Balor when it comes to that promotion since they've been around. Nobody's had that. I feel like he might be the number one like merch seller since NXT's inception. And that may be partially because Kevin Owens wasn't around long enough to really do that.
I don't know. It may be weird. It's weird for me if they just gave Joe the belt on a house show to have him drop it at the pay-per-view. Like,
I think that's exactly what you do. You give the Mountie the Intercontinental title so he drops it to Roddy Piper at Royal Rumble. Right?
You pulled that one out. That's the thing that happened.
Well, I mean, you got to remember, Ric Flair won the world title on a house show.
Yep.
He won the world title from Bret Hart on a house show.
Didn't Kevin Nash win the world title on a house show with Bob Backlund?
Yeah, Bob Backlund. Mm-hmm. By the way, we're talking about the worst era in professional wrestling. So.
This is true. This is absolutely true.
Hey, that match between Diesel and Bob Backlund was an 8-second classic. Mm-hmm. All right? Mm-hmm. And Riz says he thinks the number one merch seller is Bailey. Yeah. And I can't argue that.
That's true.
Because
I believe that.
I have a lot of Bailey merch.
I've seen a lot of I'm a Hugger shirts, like in indie wrestling, everywhere. Everywhere. Absolutely.
Ironically, not on wheels.
That is true. I got to get me a shirt.
No, you don't. The point is, no, you don't. No, no, no.
Don't be jealous, Sorg.
I think somebody needs to wear that shirt next to you to get residual hugs. So if you see Wheels at a show,
show title, Residual Hugs.
Residual Hugs. There you go. Oh, geez. Aside from that, we got Asuka and Nia Jax. Again, as I said, it was I saw that they solved the contract signing problem by having a small table. The table survived. We're good.
Yeah, but I mean, Sorg, sometimes small tables don't always survive.
No. We'll talk
about that later.
No, that's the next segment. That's it.
We're not talking about
not
that.
In the Hardy household, right?
hey, Sorg, the Hardy complex.
I don't want to give him my breath. God damn it.
Oh, we're going to watch Eamon's head explode in segment two, by the way. If you used to enjoy rants or need to skip over a rant, it's coming up. But anyways, NXT, at least we know American Alpha Revival is going to be kick ass. I think.
Hey, okay, before we go any further, there's a new superstar that they're doing on TakeOver. And before anyone says anything, I want Sorg to try to pronounce his name.
Ooh, that's an excellent idea.
No. I heard it, though. It's, oh, crap.
Well, you've already mispronounced mispronounced Finn Balor and Asuka, so
no hints from the audience.
No hints from the audience. They're in the chat.
That doesn't help.
Oh, I heard him say it. I heard one of the guys say it. And it wasn't what I expected. Andrade.
Yeah.
Oh, I got that. Okay. Yes. CN.
Yes.
Okay. This is the trick, isn't it? This is the trick. Old Mace.
No.
No.
So close.
That's the part that's
three ain't bad, Sorg.
Well, how is it? How is it?
Andrade Cien Almas.
Oh, Almas. What'd I say?
Like Ever and James Almas.
Almas. No, I don't think that's
you keep
right.
You keep saying Finn Balor and Asuka.
Balor.
It's okay.
Balor, right?
Said that. You just called him Finn Balor since he debuted. And I've never changed.
It's okay, Sorg. It's all right.
It's hard, man.
Aww. To be fair, sometimes Tom Phillips screws it up, too.
Well, you know. I figured it's okay since I don't have the accent. That's not how that works.
I do have a question about the tag match, and I don't think we brought it up. Do we think Ciampa and Gargano are going to be added to the match?
No.
I think they might be.
Why, Sorg?
I think that was a one-off thing that will lead to them coming out the next show and continuing some sort of feud with Revival, but no, I think that's it.
Either way.
So, I thought they were just kind of there for that moment. That was it for that segment. And good for them, you know. But no, they were the Zack Ryder strangely pinned the challengers for the IC belt before he got to go.
I don't think they're Zack Ryder level.
No, I mean that's not it.
Zack Ryder did win that title after he pinned someone.
That's true. And of course Shinsuke Nakamura, Austin Aries, and I pointed out. And first of all, get well soon. Good vibes going out to the Drifter that I believe fractured his ankle.
Ooh.
I think was the deal. I noticed this and that's why this is why I thought he was on a good trajectory, because whenever there was something like two guys like Nakamura and Austin Aries, I'm not saying that right. Shinsuke Nakamura.
Yeah.
That one I got. I'm not getting Asuka right? Asuka. Okay. Ooh. Asuka.
And Finn Balor.
Listen, I'm still. No, the reason I messed up with Asuka is there was a character in Street Fighter that had the same name, and I've been mispronouncing it for like 20 years. So I'm still readjusting. So then I learned that you know,
I can't wait till all the people in the Global Cruiserweight series come in.
Oh geez. Understand, I've been reading Japanese names in video game magazines for like my entire life. You know, and don't ask me when.
You realize they're backwards, right?
What?
I don't know if they're backwards.
Well, they're backwards. What's backwards?
If you say someone's name in Japanese, you say the last name first.
Mm-hmm. No, I mean like developers, like they're said like Shinsuke Nakamura. Wait, is Shinsuke his last name?
No, his first. No, that's correct. But like if you're in Japan and they would like ring announce him,
Nakamura Shinsuke. Like you hear that? Yeah. No, yeah. I've paid attention to New Japan.
No, Sorg watched Dragon Ball Z. He knows it's Son Goku, not Goku Son.
Okay.
Yes.
Yeah.
I just want to make sure.
That's right. Damn it, Eamon. I'm cultured. Fuck you. I'm cultured.
Fuck you. I'm cultured. Wrestling Mayhem Show, whatever episode. Fuck you. I'm cultured.
What was that other thing I forgot?
No. We already figured out the episode name.
Residual Hugs.
Thank you, because I didn't write that down. All right. So, anything else to say about that or Almas?
Almas
against Ty Dillinger.
I think Takeover is going to be Almas on this
game. I want weekly language lessons from Eamon and
I'm just going to give you a random Japanese wrestler's name and tell you pronounce.
You help me with the Japanese wrestler names, and I'll learn Spanish from Garza, and we'll be good. So, but anyways. Anyways, what do we think about that? What do we know about this guy coming in?
I've seen him wrestle.
Cool.
He was La Sombra.
In CMLL.
In CMLL, but I saw him wrestle under his NXT gimmick in Poughkeepsie.
Okay.
Yeah, they called him Manny Andrade. I guess I'm assuming this was before they came up with the new name for him.
Not new.
No. He came in to Crickets. He was wrestling Ciampa. No one knew who the hell he was. By the time the match ended, people were chanting for him and giving him a standing ovation. He's going to be a big deal. And
I also love
a lot of fun.
I also love that he's in that Del Rio position where they're like, hey, take your mask off because you look like you have a face for people to be seen.
Like, he looks like a Greek god. Except Spanish.
He looks really good. So like the fact that he wrestled in a mask for years and like now and like it's like the case of like, why would you ever wrestle in a mask?
Yeah, like
it's kind of like
you are classically a handsome individual. Why are we covering this up?
You're not a psychosis that we're going to put the mask back on.
Yeah, basically.
Yeah, psychosis is going
on. Yeah,
for honest.
All right. On that note, NXT Takeover coming up this week. We're all going to be watching it. Watch us on the check out the Twitter at Mayhem Show. I'm sure there'll be some responses. I'm going to try to get to my hotel room in time to watch it and hope the Wi-Fi holds up.
And for those of you who will be waiting for the midweek war this week will depend on how late the Pens game ends.
Because we can't, midweek war, we care more about hockey than we care about you.
Eamon, if it wasn't the playoffs, there wouldn't be an issue.
Here's the thing. I don't understand people's affiliation with hockey. We're not going to get on this rant.
Because you're from the desert. Because
literally every time we're...
Eamon, when was the last time you saw ice?
It's like... Oh, man.
Like, not in cube form, in a continuous block. And when's the last time you actually saw ice? Have you ever slipped on a sheet of ice in your life?
I watched an ice train match recently. Does that count?
No, you damn well know it does not count. Nor does a glacier match.
Fuck you.
Nor does playing a Sub-Zero in Mortal Kombat.
Wait a minute. Wait. Mike?
Yes.
Isn't Eamon actually Canadian?
No, we established this back several hundred
years ago.
I am also not a European woman.
That's true too. Also to call, because I'm getting called out in the chat room. The guy that made Metal Gear Solid is Hideo Kojima.
Sorg.
Video games. Fuck you. Anyways, that's a perfect time to go to a sponsor. I'm hyped up on pepperoni, damn it. That's what's going on. That's why I'm punchy, because I'm hyped up on the sweet, sweet awesomeness that is Slice on Broadway. Our good friends at Slice on Broadway, sliceonbroadway.com, the fine folks that are supporting Pittsburgh podcasting with the perfect pepperoni pizza, now residing at PNC Bank. No, geez, not the bank, the park, home of the Pittsburgh Pirates. Our good friends here along the tracks, just blocks away here in Beachview, as well as on Main Street in Carnegie, PA, and also, like I said, at PNC Park, home of the Pittsburgh Pirates. You can get a slice while you're hanging out down there, Cole Cabana, and go check them out. They've been supporting the show for a while. People are rolling here. In studio guests. I know we don't get a whole lot here on the Wrestling Mayhem Show. We've had a few. Our friends BC Steel dropping in, for instance, last month and everything. Helps get them in here. Gets us some people, some FaceTime with people instead of the digital FaceTime I get with the Yahoos, which I think makes the show better.
Who are you talking about, Yahoo?
Yeah, you. Come on. Anyways, Slice on Broadway, sliceonbroadway.com, PJH_Slice. They're also, hey, go check out the city paper's Best in Pittsburgh, and you can go check them out. Vote for them as Best Pizza in Pittsburgh. Support them. Thank you, Slice. Thank you, Slice. All right, let's bring it down. There's going to be warning. There's going to be a lot more swearing in this segment. And we've already started.
I'm reading Twitter and live tweets about stuff that's happening right now, and I'm not happy.
You're not happy. Impact is going on right now, and Mike's dancing.
Why are you so excited?
Because I love seeing Eamon get angry.
This is a sad day.
They're such a horrible, horrible company.
So.
Oh, come on, Brother Eamon. It's okay.
Brother Eamon.
Don't even
with
me.
Oh, man.
What's Eamon's middle name? Can we call him that? What's your middle name?
No, let's not go into this. Let's not talk.
I kind of want to do this now.
No. Man. Fucking TNA. Stupid.
Okay,
shit.
Okay. Well, okay. Other than FTNA, this. Like, I don't want to like TNA bash to TNA bash, but man, we can't pass this up.
But see the thing. All right, I'm gonna break down why I want to talk about this.
Okay.
Because and also,
please expound on the thing that we're kind of going off about.
Oh yeah, I'm going to. Basically, TNA did a segment this week involving Matt Hardy kind of going a little insane and inviting Jeff to his house for contract signing. And basically, it was a horribly produced segment. It had pianos and kitchen tables. And slow motion, and it's just not a good segment.
A Mexican gardener.
To give you perspective on it, because I don't think we can put it into proper words. I saw someone on Twitter mention it, and I think it's extremely accurate. This is basically our modern day, like White Castle of Fear,
or Lost in Cleveland.
Like this is like that level of terrible.
Yeah. But you know, wrestling companies put out horrible segments. Fine, we're used to that. We've all seen Katie Vick.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, we're used to stuff like that. But the reason I wanted to talk about it is not only a first shout out to our friend Legkick TKO. She made a lot of amazing remixes of a part of the Matt Hardy segment this past week. Hashtag keyboard Matt. You will be impressed and you will laugh very loudly. But basically, TNA has responded to the internet's backlash of this video own parody video.
Okay, let's roll back. So you invite someone into the house. He's like doing this Phantom of the Opera piano thing, right? Invites him out to like a steel building, I imagine is in their field, with a wrestling ring in it and a questionably placed table.
Clips his head on the bottom rope and around the ring. Didn't think to reshoot it at all.
Wait, what?
When he runs under the ring, Matt clips his head on the bottom rope.
Yeah, okay. He did.
Okay.
I just think he couldn't adjust for the extra hair volume.
That's true too.
Yeah, don't make excuses for him.
and that happens, and then they get in the ring, and he's yelling at him to sign the contract and everything, and Rebby comes in and throws a baby at him. That's a fake baby.
#prop baby.
There's also some really great like errors that I didn't even realize. Like when they start the scenes in the shed, like there's a garage door that's to the left that's open, and when Rebby comes in, the garage door is completely closed.
Mm-hmm. Yes,
mm-hmm. Like stuff like that. Like,
and then he gives him a side effect or whatever.
So Eamon, there were reshoots. This was yeah, the best, there were reshoots. This was the best version of this.
Oh fuck.
So yeah, there's that. There is.
But yeah, so Rebby throws a prop baby at Jeff. Jeff gets distracted and then gets slow motion side effect off the ring apron through a kitchen table that flipped over, and it actually looked like I hurt Matt more than Jeff.
And
it wasn't really a kitchen table. It's more like one of those.
It's one of those pedestal
bars.
Yeah, it's one of those pedestal tables. Yeah, yeah. Our old dining room table is like that. Yeah, and so
it's, okay, it was like a poker table then.
Yeah, I guess a little bit. Yeah, it's just a circle kind of pedestal table, right?
It's a table you shouldn't be doing a wrestling move through.
And then from that, you tell me that TNA has responded to this.
Now, here's the thing. I don't know if TNA. Here's the thing. TNA posted this on their YouTube channel and like shared it out. This is just something I believe that a bunch of their wrestlers filmed mm-hmm. when they were in Mexico, because a bunch of TNA wrestlers were there for the Lucha Libre World Cup, which Lucha Underground won, by the way.
Yeah.
They literally just filmed it because they had some videos like recapping the weekend of them in Mexico, and part of the clip is Eli Drake editing the video on his MacBook, which is why it looks so poor on the YouTube channel.
All right, you know what? Eli Jake just jumped up to my book a little bit.
Yeah. So this isn't something like TNA produced. Like this is something the wrestlers thought, hey, we're drunk. No. Let's make this because it's funny.
Which makes you lend to like maybe just the wrestlers are producing a lot of their content these days.
It looks like it, honestly.
So I mean,
if you watch Impact, Maria and Mike Bennett definitely are.
But here's the thing.
It doesn't speak to quality.
I don't like it because here's the thing. EC3 is funny. The segment, the parody is kind of funny. Yes.
Yeah.
But I don't like TNA's response of like, hey guys, that was a really stupid segment, right?
You know, wait.
We're in on the joke.
So yeah, TNA posted it, but don't you no, you don't. It's a different era, but. Back in the day, we had D-Generation X going out and pretending to be Vince McMahon and making all these inside jokes.
But Sorg, that is different.
Why is that different?
That is actively different. First of all, anytime DX would imitate someone, they were feuding with them.
Right. Okay. I'm not saying
EC3 and Eli Drake have nothing to do with the Hardys feud.
Right. They have nothing to do with it. Tyrus and Spud are in it, who are allies of Matt Hardy.
Yes.
That just shows you how horrible it is.
I don't have a problem with parodies, but like, yeah, if it's like the DX thing where it's part of an actual feud, then yeah. But they're literally like, this was so terrible that we are wrestlers. We're just going to get drunk and make fun of it.
Yeah, I mean, it completely negates anything that Matt and Jeff do in their match at Slammiversary because TNA, by releasing it themselves, has already agreed, okay, this is stupid.
Yeah. And if you follow like Dixie Carter on Twitter, like her responses to it are very much the same. Like, oh, we're in on the joke, guys. Like, no.
You made something
on your television show that was terrible. The internet told you that it was terrible. It's not you like being like, oh, we got people talking. Like,
but they could be, and that's what they're aiming for. Unfortunately, I guess in the long run. But
that's sad. Like that's really sad. Like instead of producing good wrestling and a good wrestling show, you're gonna like release something that is arguably terrible. Actually, not arguably terrible. It's terrible. And be like, well, we got people talking.
But see, here's the issue I have with it. I don't mind if you produce a bad segment. I don't mind if you, but you have to remember it is a show. If it's a bad segment, if you're getting flack for it, take responsibility and follow it through. Don't completely throw it under the bus. Like the Claire Lynch stuff. Horrible television, but they followed it through to the end, and you have to give them credit for that. Like, I don't, because honestly, whatever they show on Impact tonight regarding Matt and Jeff Hardy, I'm disregarding it at this point. Because they've already told us, like, on through their website and everything, that they think the storyline is stupid. And they think their second main event for Slammiversary is based on two North Carolinians being dipshits.
Keep in mind, they've this Impact has already been taped.
Yep.
So they don't know the reaction of this.
And to comment to Riz, I think it went viral, honestly, because of the parody. Not because of the actual segment.
No, I think it was getting around a lot before the parody.
I know, but there's also a lot of people riffing on it is what made it viral.
Right. It just they got in on the riff.
It's not, and here's the thing, it's not something that, if we're going to compare this to Ricochet Will Ospreay, for example, because I hear a lot of people comparing the two things of it gets people into wrestling. I'm sorry, you show a couple guys doing these acrobatic flips and stuff like that, I can see people that's really impressive. This, if I show this and be like, hey, this is wrestling, this is the thing I watch. how does that make me look?
Yeah. It's kind of that idea. You go to the indie show with 10 people and you're like, okay, this is what indie wrestling is. Instead of what it could be, like a IWC show, like a Chikara show, like an Inspire show that is the better product, right? That you want people to check out and be into, right? It scares away those people. And this scares away, this is what pro wrestling is these days? And you don't go see your NXTs, even WWE Raws, that they're just much better produced in comparison.
Right? I don't see how this is going to improve ticket sales. I don't see how this is going to improve.
I don't know. It's
like if you're trying to convince someone to watch Happy Days, but you show them the episode where Fonzie jumps over a shark.
That's
not going to convince anyone to watch anything.
There were people who I shared the video out and stuff like that, and people who have not watched TNA in years were like, oh, I'm glad I'm not watching it anymore.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I don't know who you're talking to at that point. So
that being said, the only good thing to come out of this, seriously, look up on Twitter, hashtag keyboard Matt. Look it up, because our good buddy Leg Kick, she started to dub in different songs when Matt Hardy's playing piano. Oh my God, some of them are breathtaking.
Amazing.
And you don't need context for it. That's the best thing.
Well, from there, some other interesting news from TNA, I guess, in their state at this point. There was an article talking about their ad rates that came out. Apparently, according to SEScoops.com, the low ad rates for Impact Wrestling on Pop TV have been revealed, and the average cost for the March 29th run, first run airing, the average cost for a 30-second ad, $335. I've seen signups for indie shows in sponsor slots that were more than that.
Yep. Sorg, we are buying an ad on Impact.
Well, that's what I want to talk about. Wait. First of all, we get to that for comparison. I don't know why they picked this, but Days of Our Lives, the soap opera, that same day, averages for a 30-second ad, $1,100 to $1,250. Okay? And there's other things, you can get local ads as well. And I think local ads are a couple hundred bucks to get for Monday Night Raw, right? Or maybe even a little bit more, depending on your market and everything. Even what was they said on Pop TV? I think they said on Pop TV there was an airing of the 1998 movie You've Got Mail. Yeah, that one that made more money than this. But anyway, you've got mail averaged 30-second spot $406. So actually, I think we need to drop an ad into that. So with that, I would like to announce a new initiative on the Wrestling Mayhem Show. We're always looking for new ways to grow listeners, right? Grow our fan base, expand the Mayhem Nation. And from that, I want to announce our first ever GoFundMe is over here. You can go to, I don't have a short URL for this, but if you Mayhem on Impact, the GoFundMe, we'll be having this out in our social media. Probably throw it in the show notes as well. If you want to support that, I'll throw in the chat room for you guys. Apparently, way to set up a minimum $5 for you guys to submit, but we're looking for $400 to, because it was the average for $335. So I was like, hey, let's get a prime spot and go with $400 here. We want to put a Wrestling Mayhem Show ad on Facebook. And we've done ads, we've done 30-second spots before, just kind of general stuff for Sorgatron Media, and if the Mayhem Nation would be down with it, and help us raise the money, you know, I'll throw a couple bucks in myself as well. We just kicked this off, and let's see if we can get a Wrestling Mayhem Show, a podcast about wrestling, having a commercial nationally on TNA Impact Wrestling. No, the numbers aren't great for them, but it's still numbers I'd love to have for this show. We would love their audience. In fact, Pop TV, if you're looking for a replacement in the fall season and need to fill 2 hours of BS content, we're your people. We're your mans. I was going to say we're your man. We're your men's. We're your bromans even. We have variety. Yes. We have a very diverse cast of characters here.
Mm-hmm. And I worked for WWE once. I know
that's right.
You guys look for that stuff.
You love people that used to work for WWE. That one gets hugs from Karen Jarrett. You love people that get hugs from Karen Jarrett. So please, consider us.
Probably not anymore.
Well, maybe less so now. At one time. But still, there's a history. And I think we check a lot of the boxes for you guys for that. And but in the meantime, we have the GoFundMe, GoFundMe.com, Mayhem on Impact. Go search for it. We'll be linking it out if you're interested. Let's see if we can get a commercial on Impact Wrestling. Let's see how this does.
We also have smoother transitions to plug Schitt's Creek than Josh Matthews.
There you go. We have.
I don't know. His transitions are pretty seamless.
Nobody.
Yeah, they're like cobblestone roads.
Nobody on this show has as lousy a tattoos as Josh Matthews. That I can guarantee you.
That's true. That's a fair point. Yeah.
That was the most revealing thing about their parody. I was like, that's Josh Matthews. What? Anyways. Pope D'Angelo De Niro, not included in this offer. Anyways, anything else about that? So we got our quarterly TNA bashing out of the way. I feel better.
Can we not talk about this for another 3 months?
Yes. I thought you were going to get more angry.
Just in time for Bound for Glory.
If you want to see a lot of... We don't pay well, so it is like TNA. Yeah, that's about right. But anyways, if you want to see a lot of people on TNA in a way better atmosphere than you're currently seeing them right now, I invite you to come over to indiewrestling.us. There's a lot of great stuff over there, including a lot of great guys that are in there. A lot of guys, you know, the friends of the show, even like DJ Zima Ion having a knockdown drag out match last month at Reloaded 2.0. A lot of great stuff going on over there. Or how about the latest Queen of the Ring from Vicious Outcast Wrestling? Some great stuff from Prime Wrestling, some Before They Were Stars, some Women of Prime Wrestling, RWA's March to Victory, new shows coming out very shortly, Caged Combat, including Brutal Bob Evans of Ring of Honor, and of course, check out the great Around the Indies, including a lot about that other thing people have been talking about, the fall to end all falls in death matches with Zandig and Joey Janela, who was supposed to be an IWC Super Indie, but unfortunately, no. And of course, we have a lot of, it's a multimedia presentation there. A lot of Facebook, Twitter videos all being compiled by our good friend in the mainstream media, Matt Carlin's. Thank you so much for putting that together. And of course, over here, you can find a lot of our interviews from Indie Mayhem Show and a lot of friends of the show there. Look up if there's an indie guy, CM Punk, Sterling James Keenan, the former Corey Graves, the Drifter, the former Logan Shulo. They're all on here. Guys of yesterday, Shulo. Of yesterday and today. Thank you for that. Digital downloads, DVDs, Prime Wrestling, Vicious Outcast Wrestling, International Wrestling Cartel, Renegade Wrestling Alliance, and also, don't forget, the Legend of Virgil and his traveling merchandise table. So much more. Check out indiewrestling.us and support the show. Support our friends in indie wrestling. You are supporting indie wrestling with this, by the way. It's like they're partners in this as well. All those groups that we just mentioned. So please go check it out. All right, we're going to go do a little bit of thing I like to call an interstitial, and we'll be right back with a big question, and the Mayhem Draft commences.
Hey, listen up. This is SJK, Sterling James Keenan. You're listening to the Wrestling Mayhem Show.
It's the Wrestling Mayhem Show. Mike Sorg at Sorgatron with us. Amen to please in San Antonio. Mad Mike in Poughkeepsie. And, of course, the Riz has actually joined us. He's going to be joining us here for the draft.
You can't even say San Antonio, Sorg.
San Antonio? Who says San Antonio?
He said it.
He said San Antonio.
Did he really?
That's where Judge Doom is looking to build a freeway.
I have no idea what's going on, but it's time.
Montana Max is going to be so happy.
It's time for the big question. And yeah, we kind of riled on TNA a little bit, but it's so it's TNA. So I thought, you know, we witnessed something pretty horrible. And witnessed ultraviolent wrestling last month with 16 people in North LA. So I thought it'd be interesting to see, and a few of us have lived through the later years of WCW. Some of us have lived through the earlier years of WCW. Some of us lived through early Raw, you know. What is the worst thing that you've seen, skit, match, angle, whatever, in professional wrestling? Eamon, I understand you have one that's freshly burned into your brain.
Actually, now that I think about it, I have two, but I'm only going to say one.
Go ahead. I'm sure.
Your mention of that like, reinvigorated one in my head. This is one that I actually watched yesterday, courtesy of the WWE Network, and I have never seen before yesterday. Just randomly watching stuff on the network. Do you guys remember back in WCW? That old place. There's this thing called the NWO.
No.
Who?
No, I think I've heard of that, yeah. Tell me more about this.
They're kind of like that Bullet Club thing. But they, many people may not know this, had their own pay-per-view at one point.
Oh, God. Yeah. I've wanted to do a watch party for this pay-per-view.
Called NWO Sold Out from Cedar Rapids, Iowa. Mm-hmm. the most rebellious place in the world, Cedar Rapids, Iowa.
Hey, isn't Seth Rollins from Iowa?
He is from Iowa.
He is from Davenport, Iowa. Yes.
But you know, there were some matches on the show. Stuff happened. NWO things happened. But there was also a running theme throughout
Yes, I was hoping this is it.
Which was the Miss NWO contest.
Thank you.
Which is, I've heard about before, but I didn't realize was the worst thing I probably could have ever seen in my entire wrestling life. See, I think, Miss NWO contest. We'll probably grab some models to do some, you know, maybe models who have maybe some acting experience or something. No, they grabbed, like, real people. And not only that, but they grabbed, like, the least attractive people you could possibly think of.
The people from Cedar Rapids, Iowa, that would end up at a WCW pay-per-view.
Who, all of them apparently liked motorcycles.
Mm-hmm. That has to be a cap. Amen. They were all models. They happened to be hand models.
One of them like, because they give a rundown of, like, their, you know, their stats or whatever. One of them was a bus driver. The winner actually was a bus driver who looked older than my mother.
Wow. There were a couple, hail to the bus driver.
There were a couple driver. Really not, like, even close to trying to be, like sex objects on that panel. And they would ask them questions about, you know, how would you do, you know, with an hour with Buff Bagwell or you know, other stuff like around that, so, like, trying to get, like, sexy answers from them and stuff like that. And their responses were a wide variety of things like, what? I can't hear you. And I'm sorry, what? Like, literally everyone didn't have an answer prepared for
Miss
anything.
Becky here is a homemaker and whose hobby is cooking bratwurst and French fries.
Yep.
Did you know that, did you know there's no space in French fries?
There's supposed to be.
This lasted so fucking long. Including the end of the crowning lasted like 30 minutes.
Miss Mary is 5'7", blue eyes, her occupation, grain inspector. Quote, men in leather and flannel get my motor running. This is like a profile of Easy Riders.
And the winner, which I believe was whoever the bus driver was, gets an NWO crown, a sash, and some flowers. And gets to sit on her throne, which is a giant toilet with the NWO logo all over it.
And it makes you wonder why the NWO never became a separate federation like they intended.
And you wonder why the NWO was popular.
Yeah. Well, listen, like we were diehard. We were diehard buying WCW pay-per-views at the time, and this is one we skipped.
Like, no. They maintain their popularity, but
I'm gonna stop you right there. I got in the early days of the NWO, that was amazing,
right? But
but when they got to NWO Wolfpack, NWO Black and White, NWO Red and Black, and the LWO, when they got to the point where Disco Inferno was a member of the NWO. That's when they couldn't. That's when it was dead.
But you don't think like that could have killed it?
I think
they're big, like, we're awesome and we're the cool guys. We're gonna have a rebellious pay per view in Cedar Rapids, Iowa.
Where were they gonna have it? In Madison Square Garden?
Someplace. It was only like a 5,000 seat building.
That's when you have it at Sturgis.
Yeah,
yeah.
You replace Road Wild with Sold Out. That's what you do.
But that contest, like, could have killed them.
And it was also on a Saturday night.
Yes.
I forgot they did Saturday pay-per-views. Like, I think that's the reason why we didn't get it, because it was a Saturday pay-per-view.
That was the only Saturday pay-per-view they did. They do, like, Clash of the Champions sometimes.
Because Saturday's cooler and edgier, apparently.
There's a curfew on Sunday in Iowa. The whole state. Mad Mike, what is your most horrible thing in professional wrestling?
Wow. Sorg, I've been giving this a lot of thought. Like, there's a few things that popped in my head. The NXT soda race, Lesnar versus Goldberg, Katie Vick, Claire Lynch.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm going to have to go with something that I've seen kind of recently. Amy and I decided at one point to go look at the TNA Asylum archives.
Oh, no.
And we did a whole podcast on this.
Is it Puppet?
Nope. Okay. It's not Puppet. Puppet was actually one of the high spots. Pun intended.
Sorry.
The knockout segment where Francine is actually raped. Basically.
What?
No. Okay.
She is physically accosted against her will.
No, she is sexually assaulted. She's not raped. That's a different thing.
Okay. All right. Excuse me. She is sexually accosted against her will.
I am staying out of this conversation.
If that happened, wrestling wouldn't exist anymore.
At least TNA wouldn't. But yeah, there was a segment with what was his name?
The guy who played Oklahoma.
Ed Ferrara?
Ed Ferrara, that's his name.
Ed Ferrara, yeah. Ed Ferrara and Francine. Francine wants to be queen of the knockouts because she's the only one in the ring that people actually recognize. And she ends up getting stripped and fondled, and there's miming fellatio. It's a whole messy circumstance. It's not good. It's really, like, and you know, you can kind of see where TNA got their roots. By the way, this is also up for free on the TNA YouTube page.
Exactly.
Yeah, they charge you for the later episodes, but don't worry, the shitty ones are free.
Yep. Yeah,
that's mine. That's
wow.
Mine. That's
what mine. About you, Riz?
So I did a little research on, like, during the Royal Rumble, I did a little research of Rumble matches on the WWE Network. Did not do the Royal Rumble. I did something far worse, which was the Super Brawl. And the one thing I remember from that, from the very first Super Brawl, I think it was the first one. Yeah, they had three giants in the ring, in different ends of the ring.
Wait, do you mean Super Brawl or World War III?
Probably World War III.
Okay.
Is it the one with the three rings?
Yeah. Yes.
That's
World War III. Yeah, whatever. That's not the point. The point is they have the three big giants in the ring on each ring. And one of them was Hulk Hogan. One of them was the giant. And then the other one featured who I'm going to mention. The Yeti.
The Yeti! Yeti!
And the thing about this is, I remember watching Halloween Havoc and seeing the Yeti as the mummy. I was not ready for the second incarnation of the Yeti, which was like some Shaolin warrior Quang type person. That, am I picturing this correct?
You're completely right.
And by the way, Quang, or not Quang, Yeti, one of the first ones eliminated.
Because also, keep in mind, he made no appearances on like Nitro or anything in between Halloween Havoc, where he came out for the first time, and this. So yeah. He just changed characters in a month.
He's a chameleon. But just the fact that he was in, first of all, I think that his Halloween Havoc title change, that was one of the worst title changes in the history of wrestling, including David Arquette.
I would say if you want to find like the worst thing, watch any of like the Hogan main events, the pay-per-views from like 94 to like,
dude, he tapped out. He passed out from a hug.
He did. And that was after the match.
Oh, fuck it.
By the way, if you guys Google the Yeti and do an image search, it'll just make your day so much brighter. Because it literally is going down every horrible gimmick just in picture form.
Reese.
Just spend some time on WrestleCrap.com, where I found stuff about that NWO sold out with the girls, with the Miss NWO. The Yeti. All right.
The Yeti.
All right. So I got one that's very indie. I know this is the show for it, but you know, hanging out with, I think one good bud from high school was still living with us at the time, and we're at Walmart. We're looking for stuff just to entertain us and stuff, and we're looking through, and we find this package, like you guys have seen the ones that were like, here's 20 horror movies in a package for like $10, right?
Mm-hmm.
So this is one of those things. It had probably four to eight shows on it, technically. It was women's extreme wrestling.
Yes.
WEW. And it is the worst stuff I've ever seen as far as indies go.
Bottom of the barrel.
It was not terribly extreme. Look at all the padding in that ring.
Were those the ones that were like that were being that were on commercials like late at night?
I wouldn't be surprised.
Like right next to the 1-900 hotline numbers.
And I can't remember the order,
but none of us went to, by the way.
At one time they switched over to women's erotic wrestling, did they not?
They did.
And they were like they had pay-per-views, but they were selling them like they probably saw the commercials because they were selling them on pay-per-view pretty much alongside the porn. And if you look at their website, it doesn't look like there's much like here. Right beside female wrestling, right beside wextremew.com, right beside the female wrestling's most violent brawls, there's hot older women crave sexy young sluts.
Yep.
But if you go through this, it's amazing because if you go through this, one attraction for this was Annie Social, who actually was like one of the strippers for Wolfpack when they played live. A wrestler on here. She still wrestles apparently.
I didn't know that at all.
You never caught that. But yeah, she's in a lot of the catalog here. Also, this is where I first discovered Alexa Lurie, who later became Mickey James.
And by the way, Sorg, Alexis Lurie was also in the segment I talked about.
There you go. And I think I just saw Velvet Sky on the cover of one of these. By the way, the show is titled Hot Body Combat. They had a PWO, Pussy World Order, which really confused me when I discovered PWO, which is Pro Wrestling Ohio, with Joe Dabrowski that became Prime Wrestling. I'm like, huh, that's interesting. It is pretty rough stuff. And a lot of the shows out of the ECW arena to prove that they rented it to just about everybody in the late 90s and early 2000s. But
that's where I saw it. What? It was after, like, it was during, like, ECW, that like these ECW days.
No, it was a little later.
It was after ECW?
Maybe like a year or so after.
Huh.
This is probably early to mid 2000s. I don't think the site has been terribly touched in a while. Well, not in a good way.
Let's not use the word touched.
Don't. Yeah, when you read off that ad, Sorg, don't say. Don't, yeah.
Still advertise like a 1 month free access thing for. Wow, you can get an annual membership for $70. Jeez. Anyways.
I was going to say, speaking of, because you mentioned like stuff like that you saw kind of in like live and in person almost kind of way. Well, not live and in person. It's funny that because now I bring this up. When we finished filming Midweek War last week, I showed Mad Mike probably the worst match, probably will win the award for worst matchup this year. From the TNA Knockouts One Night Only pay-per-view.
Oh, no. That means people paid for it.
That means people, in theory, paid for it.
That means somebody paid for it and put it on, like, the internet.
On YouTube, yeah.
At least one person paid for this.
But, yeah, check out the Shelly Martinez Rebel match. And if you want to feel bad about yourself, that's enough to do it.
Damon, I got one word for you. No.
I will not.
I've heard about this match, and the answer is no, I'm not going to watch it.
Riz, no. I think you should
no
watch
means
it.
No. No means no. No. All right. Well.
Sorg.
Yeah.
You sent me down the rabbit hole. there is a whole WEW pay-per-view on YouTube.
Mm-hmm.
It's called Extreme Takedown. the first thing I see is Velvet Sky and someone else who I'm not familiar with coming down to the ring, apparently they are tag team champions, but both belts are WCW titles.
Yeah.
I believe
they're called Team T and A.
Yeah.
And you know how, like, when normal people go down the wrestling ramp, they slap hands with people? They went around getting dollars stuffed in their shirts and their shorts.
This is This is like there's some obvious strippers in a wrestling ring in this Fed. By the way,
WWE this year.
Oh, this is how Velvet got the idea for her entrance.
There you go. So you know what? You just remind me. Let's go even further down the rabbit hole. I forgot the absolute worst thing that I saw on those DVDs.
Uh-huh.
And I cannot think of anything that could be worse.
Is it their champion, G.I. Ho?
Nope, not even. That's charming in comparison. They had a cripple fight.
Oh, what? Yeah. Yeah, their big...
Wait, what?
Their big selling point was hot women in cripple fights.
Yes.
Wait.
Yep.
What?
I think it was literally like that's how they would advertise it. Was hot women fighting, midgets fighting, and cripples fighting.
Now, I have a question.
We're going to put this on the commercial, aren't we?
That was a thing they advertised.
I have a question. I don't think I want the answer to this. You mentioned hot women, midgets, and cripples. Did they ever combine these three things into one match?
Not that I'm aware of. I think that was supposed to be the big blow off for this. And I don't know. I think I have to pay.
Of course there was a blow off.
I think I have to pay $69. I think I have to pay $69.95 in order to find that out. So, yeah.
Wouldn't that be amazing if that was a match type called the big blow off?
Everybody wins.
It books itself. You can see why they went this route.
No, it is. Nobody wins.
Someone definitely goes over, though.
The finish is going to be good.
Take it to the
We don't even need to do the... Let's just finish the show now. That's we can't go anywhere from here.
We promised the draft.
Hey, hold on. I feel a draft in here, Sorg. Feel a draft. A wave of new conversation coming
in. Yes. So let us know the worst thing you've seen in pro wrestling this week for the big question, and we'll feel a lot sorry for you. Anyways, Eamon, I think you are the holder of the rules. I think you are the Matt Carlins of this process. Can you tell us what we're doing next? Because I am not entirely sure.
Okay, so we announced this last week that we were doing a mock WWE draft, since the draft is coming up in about a month. And we decided that, you know, hey, you know, let's do this. Let's do the whole process out. I'll run down some of the rules real quick. Obviously, we're drafting as part of two teams, each representing a brand in the WWE. Team Raw is Sorg, along with Riz. As well as Dutters, Hot Wheels, and Alex Cars. Team SmackDown is represented by myself, Mad Mike, as well as Bobby FJ Town, Mainstream Matt Carlins, and Antonio Garza. We're going to determine where I think we didn't officially decide, but I think we're going to do it by coin toss. I think that's fair. To keep things fair, I have an official coin, and I promise I'll be fair with it.
Can we see the coin?
We can't see the coin. See, there's
head. That's heads.
There's the front of it, and there's the back of it.
There's tails. Okay.
Okay.
It's for, make sure.
It's for Nebraska. It's a Nebraska coin.
Nobody cares about Nebraska.
Nobody cares. Each week, there will be 10 draft picks made by each team, resulting eventually in 40 members on each team's roster. Only individuals can be drafted. Meaning that in order to draft a tag team, that you must draft each individual member of that team separately. Only in-ring wrestlers listed, and both teams were provided with the official list, can be drafted. Managers will be included as a package with the wrestler that they manage. And championship belts that are held by the current members of the roster will not be included in the draft. Meaning, if you're drafting somebody who is currently a champion right now in WWE, you don't get that belt. It will be implied that each team will have a heavyweight title, a mid-card title, a tag team title, and a women's championship. So keep that in mind as well. So we've been conferring over the weeks. I believe both teams have a good game plan going forward into this, and we're going to do this and start our first few draft picks. You know, since Sorg is the host of things and is the host of the Mayhem Show, I'm going to give him the call of either heads or tails. Mm. So Sorg, call it whatever you want to call it.
Give me heads. That goes with that last
and segment. It is tails.
Damn it.
Yes.
It is actually tails. I'm not lying.
I'd rather we had the XFL role where Mike and I scrambled for the coin.
We just run into our webcam.
Sorg, have you seen my Fitbit? Do you really want that challenge?
Sorg, I can take him. Let's do it.
Okay, anyways. So that means
16,000 steps today, Sorg.
I guess we get the choice to start, right? We get to choose who can start.
You're the rules.
Oh, yeah. No. We're starting. We're drafting.
We're starting.
No. Do you remember the first year of Mayhem Mania? There was a lot of rules being made up as we went.
There was a lot going on.
Just make sure when we make a rule, put it in the document.
Yes. So Team SmackDown starting. So that's going to be our team, myself, Mad Mike, as well as the other guys. So I believe we've been conferring about everything and discussing. So, Mike, I'll let you deliver the news. What is our number one draft pick for Team SmackDown?
All right. Our number one draft pick and calling the shot, Kevin Owens.
Okay. Kevin Owens, the first draft pick for Team SmackDown.
I think we go with Sorg.
What? Yeah, what?
Sorg, right. Is it? The floor is opening.
I think we can go safely with number one.
Number one, you like that? Number one, okay. Confer in the Slack, but I think we have to. You can't build a structure for a new Raw and an exciting Raw without an architect.
Mm-hmm.
And that architect is Seth Rollins, and we pick Seth.
Okay, Seth Rollins will be going to Raw.
That was our next pick too.
We were thinking about that.
That was absolutely going to be our next pick.
Okay. Seth Rollins is very high on our list. So I guess
I guess
we can confer. I guess who we should go for our second pick.
I think Matt had a good idea. I think Matt had a good idea with his pick. Even if you want to announce that one.
Are you talking about the most recent one?
Yes.
Okay, let's do that. Our second pick, and I guess technically we get two people with this. Will be Brock Lesnar.
Hmm. Okay, that's good.
And of course, we get Paul Heyman along with that.
No, let's do that.
Riz, let's do. Do you like my third one in there?
Yeah, I like your third one more than my second one.
Okay, but please put your other choice in the Slack so we can confer on that. But I mean,
I'm talking about the first one I put in there.
I see. There is a little bit more. Yeah. So I'm gonna go.
We just save him for next round, though.
Okay.
But your pick, yes.
All right. So I guess with that, we're really aiming for entertainment and excitement here, and I think there's nobody more exciting than Finn Balor these days.
Balor. Finn Balor.
So in which we will pronounce his name on Raw. Finn Balor.
Team.
Finn Balor.
Finn Balor.
Finn Balor.
Balor.
Finn Balor is going to be the biggest thing in wrestling. Yes. Yes, he is.
Even though you can't say his name right.
We'll get announcers who will. Can we? Do we draft announcers?
No, we'll do that.
Yeah, we can do that as like a supplemental draft.
Because I know who I want.
We all know who we want. We know who we don't want. Let's put it that way for announcers.
Renee Young.
Aww.
Oh, have you seen her in WWE 2K16?
No, she's just scary.
Don't see her in 2K16.
That's scary.
Okay, so I guess that's up to us. Mike, you want to go with the one I proposed?
You know, I'm good. I think we can get that person later. I think we should go with the one Matt suggested.
The Matt suggested before that. Okay.
Yeah. Guys, I hate to tell you this, but
if you want to see a certain person on SmackDown, guess what? The champ is here, John Cena.
You went with it. Okay, you went with it. All right, all right.
So you want me to go, Sorg?
Yeah. You want to go with the next one there, Riz?
Sure. So this is, honestly, this is one of the better, I think, members of a certain team, a member of a certain team. But we picked Kofi Kingston.
Oh,
whoa. You could have gotten him way later.
Yeah.
Okay. Perhaps. Well, by that we mean you got him at the perfect time.
We're shoring up the talent. We're shoring up the straight talent right now.
Now, Eamon, I know we're discussing other people.
Yes.
But this is just me asking, do we want to fuck them over by taking someone else from the New Day right now?
You know what? No, I think we got plenty of time for that.
Okay. Okay. All right.
Do you want to go with the one I suggested?
Yes. Yeah. You can announce that one. That's a good pick.
So we want, obviously, as you can see with our list, we need the star power, and we need a star that many would say would probably be a bit untapped as of late, or at least unrecognized as of late. Our number four draft pick. is the boss, Sasha Banks.
Oh, that hurts. That hurts.
Yeah,
that hurts. Oof.
I like it, Eamon. I like it.
All right. Riz, I think I got a second for my next pick here.
Yes.
I think we definitely need to. I believe him. I don't care what anybody says. I believe in this individual. No. What?
Yes.
Yeah. Wait, yes. Maybe Riz doesn't. I don't know anymore.
No, I agree with what you're about to say. Sorry.
But I think no matter who's behind him, I think he makes an imposing force, and I think he was on the edge of doing something really cool before he got injured. So I definitely want Bray Wyatt.
Okay.
Team Raw is Bray Wyatt.
Okay. There's only one way for us. I mean, we have Kevin.
Are we keeping track of this?
I am keeping track.
Eamon's keeping track. Don't worry.
We're on our fifth draft pick. As a
All right. So we have Kevin Owens. We have the powerhouse Brock Lesnar. We have the champ John Cena. You know what? I think we need some sort of machinery on this show, and I think we're going with the Samoan submission machine, Samoa Joe.
Okay. All right.
Cool. So it's our turn now.
Yeah.
So our first pick was the Architect, correct?
Mm-hmm.
With Seth Rollins.
Mm-hmm.
So why not have another member of the Shield on there? Dean Ambrose.
Okay. Dean Ambrose is your number five.
We lost one fan in Matt's wife.
Well, ooh. Yeah. We gained one fan in Matt's wife.
That Ambrose curfew is strong on Raw. We got the soccer moms in the last hour.
Hey-o.
Hey.
Okay. Are you kind of going?
Eamon, that last slack you said, you were in line exactly with my thinking.
So you think we're going to go with the one you just sent?
Yeah. I think we should do that because I think
that's fair. Yeah. I think that's a good idea.
Yeah.
Well, here's the thing. On our roster so far, I think people are seeing we've got ability, we've got personality, and we got marketability. And I think this person sums all three of those qualities up perfectly and is going to get perfectly in what we're going for. So our number six draft pick is Bayley.
Ooh. Hey, we want some Bayley! Hey, we want some Bayley!
Oof, they're shoring up that women's division over there.
Yes. We already got our main event.
All right.
Well,
boom.
There's a lot of talent out there. That's okay. I'm willing to wait, Riz. But
which one are you going?
I'll go with the one you guys agreed on. I have other thoughts, but you know, you're right. We need one.
We need. You know.
We need.
I'll take it from here.
Yeah, go ahead.
You almost got us, sir. Sirs, when you hinted at it, but we are going to take Big E Langston as well.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Or
yeah, that makes sense.
That's fine.
Biggie. So we have the. I can't do this right now because I'm in my seat. The WWE World Tag Team Championship.
There you go. I did the gyrations for you.
We did.
That's good.
Since the title, you did it.
Yeah, I did.
You did it, Sorg.
I did it.
He did
right there.
Good stuff. Good stuff. Right there, I don't know where your camera is. Hold on. I'll just do their camera. There you go. All right. Good. You guys.
Okay.
All right. I think we're all in agreement. We kind of need someone that is an underdog. And because we have a lot. We have a lot of big names. We got Brock. We got Owens. We got Cena. We got a lot of guys. I think we need a little guy. And that little guy is going to be Sami Zayn.
Okay.
Ooh. All right.
Sure. Yeah.
I'm thinking small too. Yeah, Riz, you thinking small? You liking that?
You got me on that one.
You got that? Yeah. I think you need a small guy that's going to perform, that's going to get the fans behind him, and that is phenomenal. I'm going with AJ Styles.
Okay.
Nice. That's a nice pick.
What round are we in?
Round 7, so we're about to... We need to get 3 more draft picks left.
I also love that this is going quicker than any Mayhem Mania ever did.
Well, we've all been conferring in Slack, too. And
yes.
Thank you, Slack.
Yes.
For helping us out with this.
We've all been conferring for weeks upon weeks here, completely.
Yes.
Their entire team.
Garza is complaining that all of our teases are cheesy as hell.
Oh, yeah.
That's fine.
You wait, Garza. you freaking wait.
All right, Eamon, would you like to make the next draft pick?
Is it the one we're kind of in consensus on, I think?
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yes, I believe so.
Okay, so I mentioned, you know, in-ring ability is great, you know. Talent's great, but like I said, I think the key is that marketability and that ability to span different markets. And I think we're going to expand to a very big market with our next pick, and that is the king of strong style, Shinsuke Nakamura.
Please do that again.
Yes.
Yes, that is amazing. So we have a lot of names on this.
I kind of threw out some too, but we have at least one name in there. What, that last one?
That last one.
All right. I think the last one. The last one has a lot of style and is pulling through some great matches lately. So, then the rest we don't agree on. Let's go for number eight is going to be Cesaro.
Yep. Oh, damn it.
Yep.
Okay. Damn it. That's a good one.
That's a good one, guys. A very European pick, if you will.
Ooh.
That's a really good one.
Oh, they already did that, didn't they?
What?
Let's give a rundown. Because this is our last round before.
We have two more picks.
Two more picks.
Okay.
But isn't it the last pick, like the announcers or some bullshit?
No. We won't. We'll do announcers at the end of the whole thing. We'll save that for the very end. But I'll run down the picks right now. Currently, Team Raw, we have Seth Rollins, Finn Balor, Kofi Kingston, Bray Wyatt, Dean Ambrose, Big E, AJ Styles, and Cesaro. For Team SmackDown, you have Kevin Owens, Brock Lesnar, John Cena, Sasha Banks, Samoa Joe, Bayley, Sami Zayn, and Shinsuke Nakamura.
Okay.
So I believe we're up next. Mike, you want to go with the one I suggested?
I think that's the best way to go.
Okay. Here's the thing. We can't just look in the present. We have to look towards the future. We have to look towards the stars of the future and the ones that are going to make an indelible impact going forward and the ones that have the most potential. And this is one that we had to snatch up. Our number 9 draft pick is Chad Gable.
Oh. Oh, Sorg.
Yeah.
Sorg.
Mm.
Ruin their lives.
Oh, you would. Please, have you seen Chad Gable? We can do anything with Chad Gable.
Chad Gable's,
I think I'm with you. We've seen Jason Jordan on his own.
Mm-hmm.
I don't.
Mm-hmm.
I think Chad Gable is the secret to Jason Jordan, and I don't have the heart to break that up.
So, that's true.
Hey, did you want your plan A or my plan B?
Because
I kind of like my plan. I think the plan B is more impact.
Like you, I do like your plan a lot.
Plan B has more impact, I think. well, we need a monster. We got a lot of little guys. We got a lot of great performers in there.
It's not Eric Young.
What? No. What?
It's not Eric Young.
What's not? No. We're not picking Eric Young. No. Sorry, friend of the show. But I think we need a Bulgarian brute, and I think we're going with Rusev.
That's mm-hmm. a good one. That's a good pick.
And that brings in Lana too.
Yeah, you guys get Lana.
Oh yeah.
Congratulations, you're first woman. Mm-hmm. Bunch of misogynistic assholes. No. I'm kidding.
It's like okay. Taking a putter in the first round.
Number 10.
Eamon.
Do you wanna do this, Mike? We got some conflicting.
I think we have to.
I think they're going to do it.
I think this is a move we got to do.
I think we have to do it, Sorg.
I think they're going
to
do it.
I think we got to do it.
Eamon, I think we have to. Not everyone agrees. I think you and I agree on this.
I think this is going to be okay. We got to play a little. This is the part. We got to play a little.
Just say it.
The draft has to get a little bit dirty.
Yeah.
Our 10th.
The dumpster jersey.
Yes.
That's it. That's exactly it.
Bastion Booger.
Bastion Booger.
Oh, well, we're kind of getting out.
Oh, shit. Yeah, all right. You know what?
You know what?
No, we are literally getting. All right,
We're getting outvoted, so we'll.
Yeah, okay, we'll do that.
I want to know what they're going to pick now.
Yeah.
Oh, you'll find out.
Well, either
next
way.
Week on the Wrestling Mayhem Show.
Yeah. Either way, I think we just secured ourselves the best women's division in this. Our 10th draft pick is going to be Asuka.
Okay.
Yes. Woo.
Yeah. Hmm.
All right.
Yeah.
All right.
Okay.
We have an international flair. We got 2 Canadians, 2 Japanese.
Sword.
The hell do we have? I guess a little bit.
Do you want to go with that one?
I think it rounds it out.
Yeah.
I think it certainly rounds it out.
And by the way, I do. Can we just, since we all like are here now, I like how we are doing this live on
Slack is Spotify. Amazing for this. I'm loving how this is working out.
And we're not being outvoted either. Sort of.
And by the way, and also still runs smoother than Mayhem Mania did when people were picking matches.
But here's so basically we have a last. So we're doing this 10 rounds every week,
well,
right?
Four rounds of 10 picks.
Yeah. Okay. So.
I think it'll get way more interesting next week.
I think at the last, like after the 4 rounds are done, we can do a supplemental draft of like 10 people, but they can be announcers or anything. Yeah.
So Sorg,
mm-hmm.
I'm going to throw out a name. I don't want to do that name. I don't think this is a good
pick. Well, while you guys are conferring on your last pick, Eamon, do you want to run down our first ten draft?
Yeah, first 10 for Team SmackDown. Sword. We have Kevin Owens, we have Brock Lesnar, John Cena, Sasha Banks, Samoa Joe, Bayley, Sami Zayn, Shinsuke Nakamura, Chad Gable, and Asuka. That roster's looking pretty pretty.
SmackDown is looking pretty fucking dope, y'all.
You're right. Go for it, Sorg.
We're doing that? All right. I think we need to round it out. I think, you know, everybody's been controversial over this person, but you know, I'm sorry.
Oh, no.
I got to have a Samoan.
I knew it.
Roman Reigns was number 10.
What is on his head?
Believe that. It's a Steelers hat. He's supporting the home team. Did you know?
He needed to wear his Penguins hat.
Did you know about the Samoan demographic here in Pittsburgh? No, you don't know, because he's hanging out in my basement. I knocked shit over.
Wow.
I knocked some stuff over. Oh, God.
Beer.
I've just been speared out of the podcast.
He lasted 19 picks.
Yeah, he did.
The WWE World Champion.
Yep.
And I'm going to be honest, we did not discuss Roman at all.
No.
We did not discuss Roman once.
I wonder.
And you guys discussed John Cena.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Mm-hmm. Dude, we have Cena and Bayley. Our merch sales are going to be sick.
Oh, we got.
I like how we're.
And Owens!
We do have Balor.
Balor.
Balor. I said Baller. I'm getting closer.
Closer and far away. So
yes. Well, we've had requests. I've been getting private messages for people that want into this game while we've been doing this game.
Really?
Yes.
So Sorg randomly put them in each one of our slides.
I'm totally down with that.
I can't add these people to Slack.
Wait a minute.
What?
Please do not take that out of context.
Let them slide into our DMs.
I didn't read this just yet, but I know we were kind of getting called out by Tragar as well.
Tragar always calls us out. We've had that.
That's his thing.
We also need people to vote in this.
Yeah.
Once we have the rosters complete.
This is true. About who did the better job, yeah?
Right. Mm-hmm. Once this whole thing is completed, the Mayhem Nation will get to vote on who did the better job. Mm-hmm. And that's how we'll decide our eventual winner.
And Eamon, are you going to do articles like we did with a kind of a breakdown of how everything went?
We can do that. Absolutely.
Can you do that? And also post the roles like you have them and anything that we kind of amended as well. Because then if you guys out there, if you can get a group together, I would love to see if any Mayhemers want to do this, take our roles.
Yeah, if someone wants to do an NXT group.
Yeah.
Well, I think it's, I don't know. I think at this point we should stay locked in with who we have. Yeah. But if you are very interested in what we're doing, I'd say, contribute your thoughts, give your thoughts on how our draft pick has each week has gone. And like I said, there will be a voting at the end, so you can make your voices heard in that mode.
But I'm
or
saying,
if you want to donate to Patreon, you could be a guest draft pick for whichever team you want to be on.
But I'm saying, if you put the rules up and everything, like if any of the Mayhemers want to get together and make their own teams,
and do their
own mock draft, I'd love to see how theirs shake out. Tragar is going to do his own mock draft as well. Utilizing his is going to be more of an indie one, utilizing wrestlers not in the WWE roster and kind of make a best of both. So definitely
do your own.
See, I couldn't do that because all of my 10 draft picks would just be EC3.
Well, there you go.
All of them.
And then the next 10 would be all Lucha Underground, right?
Yes.
So
you are correct.
There you go. But check that out. He's doing his thing at breakingtrayfabe@wordpress.com. Of course, his blog is also linked in our Wrestling Mayhem Show Facebook group. We're going to be splitting this out, and it'll be its own video as well. And Eamon will have the post, and we'll link all that stuff together, so it's all in one place. So you guys can comment on and let us know what you think of the draft and how do you think it's going so far, what should we be doing better differently, or whatever the case may be. And you can drop any of those lines over to, of course, goodtimes@wrestlingmayhemshow.com or even 412-206-WMS0. All right, guys, it's that time of the show. And I'm sorry I didn't get this out to Facebook, so we have the chat room, and that's about it right now. But let us know, what did you learn in wrestling this week?
Go ahead, Mike.
You can go first.
I learned in wrestling this week that WWE refuses to commit.
Hmm.
particularly with that women's segment last night.
Really?
Why can't they commit on anything that they do with Charlotte?
Okay.
I think they're getting a lot of backlash for it.
Who cares? She's a heel.
No, I know that, but given Charlotte's history with familial issues, it's probably not the best thing.
I don't know. That's something that should be a reason to do it. That comes from a real place. Like we had this discussion, I think, last week about it. But like the fact that they just won't, they're so afraid to just step on any toes. It's like, come on, people. Let's just have them do it and, you know, just fucking play it out, you know? It's, I don't know.
Okay. I learned this week that I love the WWE's binge watch feature on the network now, finally.
Thank you. Is that across everything? I saw it was on the iOS app. Is it like on the TV apps too?
I have not tried on any of the TV apps, but it's definitely working on the iOS. And oh man, I've watched so much Swerved, and it's damn funny, the second season.
Nice.
It is really, really good. I highly recommend it.
Awesome. Awesome. I can't wait. I haven't had a chance to catch up on Swerved or anything yet. So that's cool. I've been waiting for that.
I also learned that Jen Collins and I actually happened to watch it in reverse order.
That's great.
Because the way they have it listed, the last episode is posted as the first box.
Yeah, they do that for like pay-per-views and everything. It's confusing as hell.
Yeah, it is, because Jen watched it backwards. I'm watching it forwards because we both said we were watching Swerved. I was saying things that she hadn't seen. She was saying things that I hadn't seen. It was very odd. Riz, how about you?
I learned that the way they're doing John Cena versus AJ Styles is the way everybody wanted them to do John Cena versus The Rock. And it's working tremendously because that was one of AJ Styles' best promos last night. One of his best. And he's going up against John Cena. And he stood toe-to-toe with John Cena. So that alone makes their match at Money in the Bank so much awesome. And then John Cena one-punches both Gallows and Anderson. Yeah, and then ruins it. But still, it's pretty damn good to have those two in 2016 go up against each other. Like we don't have to wait until they're both old and decrepit, like we did with Triple H and Sting. Mm-hmm. We don't have to wait until one's like ready to go on and the other, like a Hulk Hogan versus Shawn Michaels or The Rock.
Yeah,
actually the Shawn Michaels one I did, it was okay, but the Rock and Hogan but to see those two in their prime-ish area is going to be phenomenal.
I did it phenomenal. So I learned that I completely forgot that I fell asleep during the end of Raw last night. Sorry, there was no wrap up. I haven't got much sleep, but anyways, and aside from that, the real what I learned last this week in wrestling was I can't get enough of Colt Cabana dancing from Friday night. Look at him go. This was the greatest thing. I love this started happening and both Matt Carlin's and I pulled up cameras and just started shooting it. We're just like, something's happening and we gotta capture this.
Why was he dancing to begin with?
They just won a six-man tag. It was Jared and Cabana and Lance Hanoi against Pepper Parks and some other people. And the one guy's actually exiting in front of him from the ring, and he's kind of mocking him. So,
yeah.
And it went on for a lot longer. This is the tail end of it. So,
And of course, Jeff Jarrett wins.
Well, all Jeff Jarrett wins. It's his own promotion, and it's basically a house show.
Promotion.
Yeah, yeah. Not a lot of heels winning this evening. So there you go.
Sorg, we have some comments from the chat room.
Oh, awesome. What do we get?
From Bobby, he learned that Raw was a lot more watchable with the fast-forward button this week. Good matches, but light on story. Wheels learned that he's huggable. I think we all knew that already. And Garza learned that TNA makes better movies than WWE films. Hashtag Matt Hardy brand.
Well, first of all, no.
Yes.
See no evil.
I will say it's partially true. Because some
see
of
no
movies,
evil.
See No Evil was a very good movie.
I'll say it's not completely false. Yes.
Yes.
All right. Guys, it's been a blast. I feel like we've been here forever. I don't know how long the show is going to end up in edit, but it was a lot of fun. Great conversations tonight. I love when we get Mayhem and Mad. It's always great to hang out here on Tuesday nights. Wrestling Mayhem Show, WrestlingMayhemShow.com.
It's what the people want. In it?
In it?
In it?
In it?
Brother Nero. I knew you'd watch Mayhem.
So from this, everybody check out WrestlingMayhemShow.com. Join us live at WrestlingMayhemShow.com at 8 p.m. Eastern time and for as long as things end up. Holy crap. As they go, hey, you know, get away from things where we're talking about the stuff we dig. You know, technology before this with the awesome cast, wrestling with this, you know, as we do.
And me just tweeting Eamon various quotes from that video.
Oh, I saw those.
Brother Nero.
So for all thank you so much to our crew at Brother Eamon, Brother Riz, and Brother Mad Mike. I'm Brother Sorgatron. Thank you to...
I think that's someone different.
Yeah, thank you also.
Yeah.
I think Brother Sorg is someone.
His brother, yeah, that's true too. thank you to Brother Wheels, Brother Garza, and the rest in the chat room. Bobby FJ Town, Brother Bobby, in the chat room. Helping us, hanging with us all night long. Brother Tragar, the whole crew. We'll see you guys next time. Mayhem out. Just wait. This show is a member of the Sorgatron Media Podcast Network. Find out more at sorgatronmedia.com. You guys are cool.